Hosting provided by Host Tornado. They offer website hosting packages, dedicated servers, and VPS solutions. HostT.net.
Programming Throwdown, episode 21. Mailbag?
So, this is a pretty exciting episode, mailbag episode. One quick thing before we get started, if this is your first time, if this is your first episode that you've listened to, listen to a different episode. So basically, this is, we've accumulated a lot of questions throughout the other episodes, and so this is our chance to sort of answer a lot of those questions and sort of engage in a dialogue about that. But you know, this is deviating highly from the original format of the show. And so if you kind of want to get an essence of, if you want to learn a programming language or get an essence of the show, watch the 1-4.
Okay.
So, with that said,
well, maybe actually the guests will be funnier than us, so then it'll make this episode better than the other episodes.
Oh, that's true. If you didn't like the last episode, watch this one.
Okay. And if anybody who ends up on this episode is better than us, we're going to kick you off and make you start your own podcast.
Yeah,
totally.
So basically...
Take it away with the news.
News.
Or a personal... We have to start with the personal story.
So, you know, they're having the hurricane, Hurricane Sandy. Actually, they had the hurricane. Mm-hmm. And, as Floridians, we've been through plenty of hurricanes ourselves. And one thing that I always wondered was, why don't they set up, like... Why don't they have a mode in your cell phone where you can do like some kind of ad hoc? So, for example, let's say the cell phone towers go down, right?
Wouldn't there be a cell phone mesh network?
Yeah, like a cell phone peer-to-peer network where you could call people, and as long as one person in the network had access to the tower, then they would, you know, you'd be able to get your call through. Mm-hmm. And so it turns out they have something like this, but for like policy reasons, it's not completely implemented. So in some phones, like in some circumstances, you can actually call 911 and it will route you through other phones, which is pretty incredible. And it's something that's not on by default. But like, so just a heads up for people, the technology behind broadcasting, and correct me if I'm wrong, you probably know more about hardware stuff, but so any cell phone can also broadcast. So like if you can receive, you can also broadcast. Something to do with like the physics behind it.
Well,
like,
it's a two-way communication.
Yeah, but so, I mean, like, the tower can talk to you, and you could talk to the tower, but you can also talk, like, broadcast outwards.
Well, I mean, if you're talking to the tower, you are broadcasting.
Oh, really? It's not like a cone or something?
I mean, I don't... So, yeah. That technology exists, but I think in general, you just have a sphere around you of, you know, gradient, just, you know, going down by the cubelar or whatever power farther away you get.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, so that makes sense then. So yeah, you can totally do it from like a physics, math.
But I think the reason it's not implemented like overall is a couple reasons. One, like if you ever study like sensor networks or whatever, you know, it's like certain nodes happen to become like gateway nodes or like key nodes that a lot of stuff flows through. And if you become that guy, your phone's gonna drain.
Oh.
You're just gonna like have your phone in your pocket, not using it, and go back to it and be like, why is it all gone?
Oh, that's
right.
So, true.
So like that would be that. So you have to have all this extra stuff to make it not be that. And the second thing also is that when the cell tower is broadcasting to you, it's got, for all intents and purposes, infinite power, right? It just sits there and beams out really strong as whatever limits they have set. But your cell phone has very limited, so it hears quietly, but then it also talks quietly. But the cell tower has very expensive antennas and equipment to be able to, you know, receive that quiet message and pick it up from the noise.
Oh.
So I think that's the whole mechanism. Versus if you're talking to other phones, it's not going to have the same range as you to the tower.
Gotcha.
Because the receiving antenna on the other phone isn't as strong. So it would probably work, and in some instances probably would be better, especially in densely populated areas like maybe like New York City or something.
Mm-hmm.
But in most regions, like I don't think you're going to, I wouldn't know what the range is, but it's probably not that far.
Oh, that makes sense. That makes sense.
That's my... top of the brain response. But it would be cool for emergencies, like have a special mode you put it in.
So I think the way it works is the carrier can put your phone into this mode. And so then you...
Only if they can talk to your phone.
So how does that work? Oh, so I guess you have to get put into this mode like before a disaster or something. I'm not really sure. It's interesting though. I guess it works for hurricanes.
They anticipate the disaster coming.
Yeah, for earthquakes it might not work.
One of our listeners was pointing out Batman. Yes, this did happen in Batman.
Did it really? It's totally awesome.
They subverted the phone network to detect where everybody was. Isn't that one of the movies?
Did you see the...
Oh, we should say spoiler alert. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. Well,
that's a really old Batman, but it's okay.
Oh, it's the original? Oh, then totally cool. Everyone's
not the
seen
new
that.
One.
Yeah. Right. So the... did you see the Die Hard? This is the last Die Hard. It's like the Die Hard and Never Stop Dying or whatever. I don't know. Some cheesy name. But in the last one, they were going around trying to catch this hacker. And the terminology was like, it was like palm forehead the whole movie. It's like they've gone into our interwebs and they're stealing all the webs. There won't be any webs left. And it's just like, oh, come on.
Okay, actually, we're getting a correction. I don't like this. People are correcting us while we're talking. Normally, I like to pretend that we're always right.
Yeah. Every other episode, we're always right.
But we're allowed to be wrong. It's actually a mesh protocol network.
Ah, okay.
So I listened to the Twit. You ever listen to Twit? This guy, Leo Laporte or whatever, he has like a pretty popular like general tech broadcast. And he always has people in his IRC chat room. And sometimes they have conversations back and forth with the chat room or whatever.
Yeah.
And then, I understand now why he sometimes gets distracted.
Yeah, totally.
But it's good. It's good. Live feedback.
Yeah, this is pretty awesome. So the other thing that we should talk about is the election. There's, in case people didn't know, there's actually an election going on in the U.S., which some of you, might not know or might not care about. But join us.
I'm not saying that.
I'm totally kidding. But no, it's super interesting. And the thing that's interesting to me is how every election, the technology changes, drastically, because entire 4 years has gone by. And I feel this also with the Olympics. So, as we talked about on that show, we went from the Olympics only being on TV to then you had TiVo and you could record the Olympics on TiVo. That was cool. And then it was starting to get on the internet. Like NBC had this deal with Microsoft where they had like some of the Olympic events there. And then now with YouTube, this time broadcasting the entire Olympics.
In certain countries.
Yeah, in certain countries, yeah. There's still policy problems. But from a tech standpoint, it's cool to see every 4 years, like, a massive leap. Like, not just a quanta of leap, like a gigantic leap.
I was watching Katie Couric on a rebroadcast on ABC being rebroadcast live on YouTube talking about the number of Twitter users this year versus last election.
Yeah.
And how that has ballooned, up a lot. And I would say even Twitter's, what is the cliche, jump the shark, right? Like, even me, like, already see people don't use Twitter the same way they used to have conversations.
Yep.
Except on those TV shows and people like, hey, Katie Couric, talk about me.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, Mom.
And they have terrible filtering on that, by the way. I saw one where it was like, it was literally like this guy was talking and the Twitter feed like was scrolling by and this one guy was like, I think aliens are like retarded. And it's like had nothing to do. He's talking about hockey. And I was like, what?
Spammer.
Yeah, it's like
he just detected like, oh, like this is a upcoming hashtag. Like start putting it in my messages. I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe.
I mean, how did they don't have like a person filtering?
I'm sure the like high level ones do.
Yeah, like presidential debate or whatever did for that.
So, but they were talking about social media, and I think that is a good point. Like people hash this out, and it's interesting to see when people post politically, which some people like and some people don't like political posts on social network. But it's interesting to see the engagement from not only, like we said, people in the United States, but people in other countries.
Yeah,
it's really interesting. Actually, people are fascinated by our process here. Yeah. It's not straightforward. It's very confusing.
Oh, it's so I mean, I tried to explain the electoral college.
Oh, I had to explain that at lunch today.
It's so
it
hard,
man.
And it's like I don't even like. I mean, I understood it, the process, but I don't understand. People started asking questions like, "Why is it like this?"
It's fairly. I mean, it's straightforward to say why, like. It's an alternative, but some people say it shouldn't be that way anymore.
Somebody said
that's the
why.
Question.
So, for example, if like let's say California has, I don't know,
people are going to be bored about politics. They're going to be like,
50.
I thought we were over with the election. Now we're listening to programming Throwdown. They're talking about politics. Okay, but we'll do
real
one.
Quick,
one real
quick.
All right.
Like if California has like 50 electoral votes, I don't know how many it has. But let's say 50. Then like if half the people voted one way and half voted the other, like shouldn't 25 go? Like the winner take all. I had a hard time. Like explaining like why that makes sense.
So I guess in theory like it used to be that way sometimes like people could decide and I think in some states it still is like Maine is still that way partly.
Yeah.
In some states it's district by district. So it's not like you say, but it's like so you have electoral college is the two senators plus however many representatives you have. And so the representatives are geographically located by a certain region,
and they
can cast votes by whatever the popular vote in their region is.
Got it.
And so that's even a more highly divided way of doing it. But I think that the whole reason like why it's like winner take all, the whole reason that Electoral College is kind of there, you know, aside from like some legacy reasons also, is to provide that, you know, you have a state like Alaska or, you know, North Dakota or something that are very sparsely populated, very few people, but they still have a lot of cares. Like, it still matters a lot to them.
Right.
So if you give them only a percentage vote like you get in the popular vote, they essentially get no say in who gets elected to president, even though they're a part of the United States, arguably, like other people are, because there's a lot of land resources there. They might produce a lot. Like, there's all these different measures of how important various states are. And
gotcha.
So this is kind of trying to be a compromise between every person is one person, and like people are proportional to the importance of their state.
Gotcha.
I'm probably butchering that, but that's okay.
It sounded good. I should have used that argument at lunch. It would have made
okay.
Instead, I was just like, I don't know.
So
on to the news.
Yep. You got the first news article.
Okay. So I think this is pretty awesome. So I run Linux at home. I have a Windows machine that I use just to play games, and mainly because my games are on Steam. And I heard you can run Steam through Wine, but it's like
I mean, you can whine about running Steam under Wine.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh. Bad puns. I'm sorry.
So yeah, so you can do this, but it's like I had a Windows machine from when I was in college, and it's kind of like, why not just keep it for this, right, rather than deal with it. But Steam is coming to Linux very shortly, and so this article is actually a press release from NVIDIA, and in the press release they talk about how Steam is going to be like, you know, they're already testing Steam like on Linux with their cards and things like that. So you can sort of insinuate from this article that it's imminent. Steam.
I also heard that it was faster.
Really?
Like I saw like something they were saying like it runs like it's actually like better.
Yeah, because I have issues with Steam. Like my computer is rather old because it's old Windows box, but sometimes if a app or if a game on Steam decides it wants to update, like it'll, instead of updating in the background, it'll just lock my Steam. Like I can't do anything with it. Yeah, so
yeah,
maybe they fixed
no, it'll
a
be
lot
great. I mean, it would be nice. The big big hindrance to using Linux or everything is this, right? Like a lot of the applications and stuff, you know, just don't work very well or aren't supported at all.
Yeah,
and totally. So as that becomes less of an issue, so I think things like also the Humble Indie Bundle, which we've talked about several times, and their big thing is it has to be cross-platform to be there. I believe that's like one of their things. Like it has to be on every platform to be featured in one of the bundles, and I think that's really good, like having developers kind of address this. And then also like as a, you know, buyer, like, you know, like if I buy that, then I'm less locked into what. So it's not just DRM. So Steam has some DRM issues. And now that they're going cross-platform, maybe some of that will be a little bit better. But there's the DRM locked in. But even non-DRM, you can still be locked in because of what the only system that supports the games or applications you have.
Right.
But as more are available across platform, then I'm less locked in and I can move back and forth how I want.
Yeah, like imagine, I mean, you know, when Windows XP, no, when Windows 98 came out, it supported USB and Windows 95 didn't. That was one of the big changes. And so, you know, if something like that happens again, and if all your games are on Steam and now Windows 8 comes out, Windows 8 supports some hardware that you need that you know, you can't upgrade. You know, so if you end up in this position where like you have to upgrade your computer, you don't want to be forced to upgrade into Windows. Like if you have the opportunity to upgrade into Linux and keep all your existing apps, like that's going to be very enticing, you know?
Yeah, I mean, this is a whole like shift in the way we purchase things. So it went from scarcity, right? Like I buy bread, then I take that, you know, those atoms and molecules home to my house, right? Like this is the scarcity thing. And, and not to get into economics of it, because don't know anything about it, but it's just like now we have less and less of that. Like we buy things which are digital, which okay, I mean, that's pretty straightforward. But then things like Netflix, like I pay every month, but I don't really own anything. If I stop paying, I lose, no matter how much money I've spent total, like I lose all of that the day I stop paying, or the next month. But yeah, so I mean, I lose that. But then you have these kind of hybrid things, like a Steam, or there's been video services where you purchase, download things, but they still have this DRM or this connection back to where if that company goes away, you can no longer authorize your stuff to play. You may or may not be able to get it kind of, you know, unlocked so you can keep playing. So you've bought a game, but the game is not exactly yours to do what you want with. And yeah. even we talked about previously about the new new consoles going to also try to do this some kind of thing about linking or locking your game to your specific console. So it's not, if that one dies and you go buy a new one or you upgrade to the version 2, like you may or may not be able to take it depending on the good graces of
yep.
the console developer and the game developer.
Yeah. So from like security, cryptography, you know, point of view, if you're not hitting the internet, so if any security measure is just on your machine, then you should be able to crack it. Like from a math standpoint.
Theoretically, eventually, yeah. with enough effort, you could crack it.
Yeah, and I mean, these passwords and things are cracked all the time. But as soon as you make it to where you have to transfer some information to and from the cloud, then you can end up in a situation where you can't crack the password, at least not easily. And so, yeah,
there's a lot of problems. And I feel like it's one of those things like, and maybe it's just, but you have like the 99.999% separate from the like 1%. But you
yeah,
know,
we
like
are
just
that.
Have like all the people out there and they're just oblivious to this. They're just giving the monies to the companies and they don't understand the implications long term, right?
Yeah.
It was the classic thing like the mother who bought for their kid like all this music on their iPod and then wanted to buy their kid a Zune and like, oh, wait, nothing works on here? Like, why not?
Yeah.
And it's just confusing
yeah.
and like, in some ways, it's like, well, what are you going to do? Like, I mean, that's, you know, caveat emptor, right? Buyer beware, right? But on the other hand, it's like you feel, I don't know. Like, we're not having a lot of choice. Like, I like when things bring choice.
Yeah,
so totally. I like things like the Humble Indie Bundle, which is, you know, no DRM or
yep.
or you know, even Steam, like now they're making it available on other things. I still, I'm not 100% comfortable with that. But if they're bringing me value, right? So, like, they will, you know, they provide an incentive for games which were no longer supported to become resupported so they can be resold at a low value on Steam because of the distribution mechanism like that.
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, there's a value there. You know, I may still want, if a game is the same price on Steam and not on Steam, I'd rather buy it not on Steam. But now
really?
That's even harder and harder because I buy it not on Steam.
Oh, without the DRM then.
Well, right, well, so that's the idea,
yeah,
right? Like,
yeah.
But you do, because now all these things that are, like, also have some other weird thing that,
yep.
like, you got to register with this thing or whatever, and it's like, oh, well, if I'm going to have to go ahead and do that for this, I might as well just have it on Steam where
yep.
it kind of handles
yeah,
all that.
Yeah, I got the Flight Simulator the other day, the Microsoft Flight Simulator,
mm-hmm.
the new one. I think it's called Flights. It's, like, rebranded.
Okay.
And, yeah, it wasn't on Steam, but it still required that I have this, like, Windows Live account on in the cloud somewhere
yeah.
and all sorts of DRM.
So, okay, well, enough talking about that.
Okay.
So, I checked out the Microsoft Surface since we're talking
Did
about OS.
Did you really?
Yes. So,
what's it like? Yeah, tell us.
So, I was at the mall and I was like, I'm going to go. So, a couple of things to note. First of all, some people out there might roll their eyes. That was the busiest I'd ever seen the Microsoft store.
Yeah, and isn't it so
many
you,
people? So, at the mall locally.
The
yeah, yeah.
It looks exactly like the Apple store.
Well, yeah, I mean, yes. But it's at this yeah. specific mall that I went to here in the San Francisco area, the Bay Area. It is right across, literally right across the street from, or the mall aisle from the Apple store. And it's crazy. It's like you can just like literally see out the front windows of one and into the other. And, okay, we're having some Okay, anyway, so you can see from one to the other. So you normally stand in the Microsoft store and there's like very few people around. Yeah, there's a couple people, somebody playing Kinect, the Just Dance game in the front.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And you look across the Apple store and you see like people everywhere, people.
Yeah.
So, but the Microsoft store does have, it's pretty nice. I go in there, you know, and it's reasonable. And when I was looking at the Surface, there was like a line, like every Surface, they had so many Surfaces set out, like so many of the tablets. We might confuse people.
Mm-hmm.
So many of the tablets set out. And like everyone, there was like a line of one or two people to like wait to try it after the person who was using it was done. So we kind of walked around and I found like this other area that like, oh, okay, like this was like to try out the keyboards, but I don't really care about the keyboards.
Yeah.
I just wanted to see the thing.
So is it running Windows 8 or was it?
So it runs Windows 8 RT, which is the ARM-based version of Windows 8. So
okay.
you can't just like bring your own applications, your old like, you know, Windows 95 applications and just run them. And when you are using it, it's not obvious that that's actually a problem. Like it's like everything just seems to work just like when you can get to like the little start menu. It's slightly different Windows 8 differences. But for the most part, it just like worked and like stuff is there and it was nice. But you know the form factor of it is a little bit strange to me. Like the
so what's
squareness
it?
Aspect
it.
Ratio of it is a little bit strange to me, like holding it. But maybe that's just because I have an iPad, so I'm used to like the iPad ratio. So it's just something different. The keyboard was it's pretty nice to
so
type on.
So how does the keyboard like? Okay, give us a mental.
Okay, so there's like a. I mean, most people you can go look on the internet. It's much easier just to see it. It's slightly more rectangular than the iPad. So like, okay. You know, the back it has a little kickstand that flips out, so it stands on its own.
Oh, I see.
And then it has the cover folds down and has keys on it.
Oh, got it.
And then you can type on it. And cool. They have two versions: one that's like a touch typing, and one that has like actual kind of mechanical keys.
Oh, so you get the haptic feedback.
Yeah. So it was actually, you know, it was pretty nice. There was a couple like instances where we were playing around, so it's my brother and I, we were trying stuff, like, and it seemed like it wasn't registering our clicks, but, you know, and I've seen some reports on the internet about people saying, like, that also happened to them, like, it kind of only half registers the click, like, the animation plays, but not the underlying feedback of what's supposed to happen, but also, it's one of those things, like, when I first got my iPad, I was completely like, stuff's not working, like, I can't slide it to unlock, like, what's going on, like, it took me a minute to get kind of, oh, you need to hold, like, get just below the button or just above, like, you know, kind of what you have to mold your brain to kind of work in the right way. So, you know, it's pretty nice. You know, you can kind of, in some ways, maybe it's a cop out. You want to say it's a version one, right? It's the first thing that they've done.
How does it work from like a developer standpoint? Do you build Visual Studio or something?
Yeah, I'm not the, like, I haven't studied as much as I probably should have to start talking about it.
But, no worries.
But I mean, I think there's essentially Windows 8 SDK, whatever equivalent, right?
Okay.
And then you essentially can build for either platform. And I'm sure if you're developing like a new app, it's probably fairly straightforward to use the limited subset of things that are available maybe on the ARM process, right? And so you can just develop for both pretty seamlessly.
Cool.
But then there might be certain features that are only available when you go to the full Windows 8, you know, stack or whatever. So that would be my, but it was pretty nice. So then I went over and tried the iPad mini.
Okay.
So having the full iPad, going to the iPad mini. So I have a Nexus 7. And the Nexus 7 is much cheaper than the iPad mini. It's $100 cheaper.
iPad mini is about the same size, right?
So I guess it's about the same size as the Nexus 7, except that the screen takes up more of the real estate.
Oh, gotcha.
So like the screen is bigger. And the aspect ratio is slightly different.
So you want to show us your awesome Nexus 7?
Oh, this is my Nexus 7. Well, people on the audio won't be
that's
like, what's
the back
going
of your
that's
Nexus
the back of it. This is the front.
Oh, cool.
You can
pretty
see.
Awesome.
Okay.
There's the time.
I think, oh, yep. That
time is pretty accurate. Pretty
okay. Seems
accurate.
On time. Seems on time.
Down
right,
to
pretty
the,
good.
Down to the minute.
Pretty good. I've got a key code here.
Yeah.
Anyways, it's locked, so nobody can mess with it.
So how does it compare?
So, you know, it seemed pretty nice, but it wasn't compelling. It's like, it's for how much more expensive it was just like, you know, if you, so for me, right, the first world problem, is that what they call it, right? Like, I have an iPad, I have an iPhone, I have a Nexus 7, I have a laptop, I have a desktop, and like, I have all the spectrum.
Yeah.
And it's like, if I just take like an iPhone, or I've used an Android phone before, and that's also, you know, fairly equivalent to me, you know, just some subtle reasons is why I chose one over the other.
Mm-hmm.
And then having a tablet, which I do think, for when I got my iPad, which has been, you know, almost 2 years now, is that at that time, like, I felt like it was much better than the competing tablets.
Yeah.
And now it's a little more even. But then having that middle one is kind of like, you know. And so if you're gonna get a middle size one, so I use it kind of like as an e-reader, right, instead of a Nook or a Kindle or something. That middle size one is nice, but you don't want to pay a lot.
Yeah.
Because you're only gonna use. It's like, if I'm mobile, I'm using my phone. If I'm relaxed, you know, at home, I'm using my big screen, my tablet. It's much better for web viewing.
Yep.
So it's only like in the car, at the airport, right? Like a few, you know, like taking it around to work meetings when I don't want to have to carry a big, like that kind of stuff the middle one fits.
The thing that's kind of funny is I've sort of seen over the like years our transformation. So I remember I was thinking, oh, I'd never really use a smartphone. And now it's like, I chop off my arm before I'd give up my smartphone. Yeah. And it was like, oh, you know, an iPad.
Yeah, you remember debating. I remember debating getting a smartphone. Like, oh, I want to pay data plan and have the internet. Oh, it's so expensive. Will I use it? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, now it's like every minute. And then I remember when we were talking about the iPad on one of the very first episodes, we were like, oh, I don't know if the tablet like really makes sense. And now it's like we use tablets all the time.
Yeah.
It's just, it's really a testament to how audacious you have to be as a hardware developer. Like, you have to make something that nobody thinks they want.
And then convince people they want it.
Yeah, and then have people's lifestyle adapt in a way that's like that fits that device. You know, it's really amazing that any of this stuff gets as widespread as it is, you know.
Yeah. Oh, so people of the podcast, listeners of the podcast may remember I have several rants against Kickstarter. I'm not as pro Kickstarter as
really?
A lot of people.
I thought you were super pro Kickstarter.
Really? I get accused of being like anti Kickstarter.
I remember you ranting about
this. I'm like kind of I straddled the fence.
Okay.
So I did see, which, you know, it's anecdotal, right? So it's not proof. But they had this really awesome iPhone dock. I think it was called the Elevation dock or whatever. Okay. It was this really slick machined iPhone dock. It's like really easy to put your iPhone down in and it would charge it. It had like an audio out port as an option. It was just really, really nice, like really high-end design, right?
Yeah.
So you would have bought it like over 12 months ago. And it was supposed to ship, I'm going to mess with the exact dates. I don't have it in front of me, but like April. Right, so it didn't end up shipping until like only like 4 or 5 weeks ago. So like, let's call it six months late. On top of it, you would have paid a fairly good price. I believe like the cheaper ones were, you know, still like I want to say like $75 type of range. I'm probably wrong on that,
yeah.
But that kind of range. Oh, that's pretty nice. But oh, it's nice, right? They didn't end up shipping, which just could have happened at any time. But they delayed. They didn't. They got way more orders than they thought, whatever, right? They delayed. It was a very profitable Kickstarter. They shipped, sold a lot of them. And then right before, when they finally shipped, some people got their docks literally the day before they got their iPhone 5s, which changed the dock connector.
Oh, no. Are you serious?
Yep. So some people were getting them who bought iPhone 5s. Well, arguably, if you're buying a nice dock, you're a... you really like the iPhone
yeah,
you're
you
using,
want to
you probably
latest,
upgrade.
Yeah.
And then, like, you're buying it and it's like obsolete.
Oh,
it's like,
ah.
So I saw that. I felt so bad for this. Yeah, so they changed the dock connector in the most recent one.
I wonder why.
A lot of reasons, but we won't get into it, into it right now. I mean, it makes sense. I'm not faulting Apple for doing it or whatever. But just another one of those Kickstarter things. You're not buying it today, you're pre buying something that's going to be made. Then it might slip. And then you finally get it. It's like,
it's already obsolete.
Versus, like, you know, if you knew you were going to buy the iPhone and you saw that in the store, like let's say, you know, the Target or Walmart, right? You knew you were going to buy the iPhone 5. You might wait before buying it because you know you're going to buy the new iPhone and there's rumors that it might be changing. But back when people bought this thing, there were no rumors that the iPhone dock would be changing.
Yeah, totally, totally.
So, or I don't think so anyways.
You have to invest so far in advance and technology changes so quickly. I'll still go for board games though. Board game Kickstarters, pretty timeless.
I could get into some negativity on that too, but
really?
I have the one I ordered. It did turn out well, and it is nice.
There you go. Which one did you order?
What is it called? For the Win?
Oh, I haven't heard of that one.
For the Win. So it's like an abstract tile laying game about pirates, ninjas, zombies.
Amazing.
And one other. What is the... Monkeys.
Amazing.
I think.
Amazing.
And so it's the tile abstract thing, and you play. Each one has like a special effect and allows you to flip over the tile or not.
Awesome.
And so it's kind of, it's pretty good. Nice. And it was a good deal. So I've enjoyed that. All right. So is it time for viewer questions?
I think it is. Let's get
to viewer questions. So we had a good response. We had a lot of people sending questions.
Yeah. Thank you guys for the questions. Pretty awesome. You have high quality, great questions, and sound effects. Pretty awesome. So let's just get straight to the mailbag. So we'll kind of mix up some questions from like the audience and some questions from
So you know, if you have a question and you're on the Hangout right now, because we do have some live listeners, looks like we have like four people, and if you have a question, just type it into the chat box and we'll either like have you read it out loud or we'll read the question.
Yeah, definitely. So yeah, type your question out in the chat box. Plus, that'll keep us from answering your question without knowing it's you and then you have to ask your question again. That's super weird. So yeah, if you have your question, go ahead and like copy it from your email and like paste it into the chat from the Hangout so that we know not to ask it, because we have actually all the questions from the email out here. So the first question is from, and I really apologize if I butcher your name, but I'm going to try my best. It's from Marco Aurelio da Silva Saraiva. And he's from Brazil, I believe. Yes, I got it right. It's a very Brazilian name. So he's from Brazil. says, listening to you guys every episode, and it's been amazing. Thanks a lot. So he wants to know how internet crawlers work. So how web crawling works. Like, so I guess I could take this one.
Okay.
So the way most internet crawlers work is they typically start with a seed set of websites. And so with most of these crawlers like Google and Bing and things like that, you can actually submit your website. So you can actually tell like Google, Bing, Yahoo, whatever, like, you know, I have this website and you should add it to your list of seed sites. So it goes through these seed sites, and for each one of these sites, it scrapes all the HTML, puts it in a reverse index, which I'll explain later, and then also finds all of the tags and then adds it to this queue. So in the beginning, the queue just has the seed websites in it.
Like, so that would be stuff people submitted on their own, but also like hub sites, like you know, Wikipedia or sites that link to a lot of other sites.
Yep, totally. So so it'll have like, you know, Wikipedia, AOL.com, Yahoo.com, etc. And so you can imagine this queue that has all these websites on it, and the system will go, it'll pick one of the websites off the queue, and then it'll store that HTML somewhere, and any images and things like that. And then for all the links, it'll add that to the back of the queue. And then it'll keep pulling web pages off and then adding more on. You can imagine this queue getting really, really, really big. You know, of course, there's all sorts of what's called stemming, which is, for example, let's say you're, you know how sometimes you go, like on YouTube, for example, you go and you search for something and there's like a million results and you could just keep paging through, right? So a stemming will know that, oh, this is really just millions and millions of these like results, but it's just kind of like a search query, and I don't really need to scan these. Like, it doesn't really make sense for me to scan these. So it'll stop there. So it's not going to go forever. It'll eventually, the stemming will make sure that you'll eventually run out of pages. So, you know, you keep, this queue keeps growing and shrinking, and then finally when the queue is down to zero, you have...
Well, it also marks, because you can have with cycles, so it has to mark and know who it's already visited.
That's right. So when something, that's totally right, when something gets pushed off the queue, it gets put onto some, like some key...
Hash map.
Some hash set somewhere, which just says like, yeah, this is visited. So eventually the queue gets down to zero. And the other thing is that this is distributed, right? So there's this queue, but you know, you're not like going to each one of these websites like on a single computer. You're pulling things off of the queue and then sending them to other computers, and then they're like going, pulling all the images and stuff, and then they're just like telling you like what new things to add to the queue. So, you know, it sounds like this would take forever, but if you have like a ton of machines, you know.
Well, no, I mean, it can grow faster than you could process it in some ways.
That's true.
Depending on like what your scale of processing is. So you just limit it to some time, or, you know, probabilistically you're going to visit the most popular websites will have the most links, so you'll kind of get them early on.
Yep. And the other thing too is you don't want to completely cream some, like I run my personal website where I have like hobby projects and things like that. Well, if like some search engine like Bing or something like hits all of my web pages all at the same time and like downloads all of the images, like it'll completely crush my computer, right? So they're pretty clever about, you know, like, oh, I just went to this computer, let's put this one back in the queue, don't process it right now. And so there's all sorts of clever details there. Okay, so now you have a ton of these pages, and you have like, think of it as a huge map where the key is the URL and the value is all of this HTML. And what you want is for somebody else to say, type in, so in this case, Marco's, he actually wants to make a Magic the Gathering like subnet. So he wants to have all this Magic the Gathering data that he's mined from the internet. So if you were to do this, Marco, and somebody types in like, I don't know, Ethereal Dragon. I'm trying to remember my Magic the Gathering cards. Or Phantom Lancer. I don't remember. Anyways, so if someone types in one of the Magic the Gathering cards, you would want to pull up all the pages that have that name in it. And so that's what a reverse index does. So a reverse index is essentially a way where you can put in a word and it'll give you all of the values, all of the documents that have that word in it. And there's like a whole bunch of crazy information theory, information theoretic things that you can do. You can actually, if you have the documents arranged in such a way, like if all the documents for one server are together, then you can actually with 99.9% accuracy create a reverse index without scanning all the documents. So, you know, it's true that like this guy's website on antique cars might have Magic the Gathering, but it probably doesn't. And if you scan five pages and it's all antique cars, and you know there's like a very low correlation between that and Ethereal Dragons, then you can just skip his entire website. And so building the reverse index has all sorts of cleverness there too. But
so there are also, I mean, people have already written web crawlers that you can use in various languages, which is really nice.
Yeah,
and totally. Also, and I'm trying to find it now on the fly. We didn't do a lot of prep going through the questions and answering as well as we could have. But there's also, if you search for like web crawling and Amazon EC2, yep. there are articles where people have written about how they do it. And there are also, and now you get into cost, right? So like you spin up an EC2 instance, so like you might have to pay for that. But there might be also data stores. Other people have already done this, the web crawling part,
yep.
which is intensive and expensive. And you can essentially just use the data. So they'll create some data store. And then you can just yep. you know, process that data store. So at least you save yourself half the
Yeah,
you know,
and one that's really great is called Common Crawl. Highly recommended. Basically, it's a totally open source reverse index of the internet. And so I think it even has images and things like that. So Marco, Aurelio, check out Common Crawl. And that way you don't have to do that part. You can just take advantage of the index they've already built.
But I mean, inevitably, this is one of those things you find out is really hard to do.
Yeah.
Like it's super, actually super like hard. Super, super hard. Like, and if you look at like Bing or Google or Yahoo, right, and like how much money they're spending like trying to do this quickly and accurately, because websites change and they go down and links come up and links go down, and you know, it's just it's a really, really big mess. And yeah. so a lot of time and money is spent by really big companies to do this really well. So depending on what you try to do, sometimes it is just is not feasible for an individual, you know, without a good profit reason for doing it to actually do it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think they said on the Common Crawl website that just going through and looking up the number of times a word is there, like if you want to see how many times the word "the" is on the internet, that'll basically cost you like $100 like yeah. in Amazon EC2 usage. So this would be an expensive hobby, but
it can be done.
It can totally be done, and it can be done in a matter of days, which is pretty amazing. So Common Crawl has all their source code available online.
So I also believe that Sebastian Thrun, am I yep. saying that right? I think yep. we've talked about him before on the on here. He does one of those massively multiplayer, massively whatever online learning things.
I think he
did two, I believe. One in how to create a search engine, and one in how to create an autonomous car.
Ah,
so
nice.
Like, you know, the kind of the background behind that. And I believe that one about creating a search engine, I would assume, talks about web crawling, at least at some level. So yeah. that might be something else to check it out. I'm trying to bring it up now, and I'm not seeing it exactly. But yeah, so I would definitely check out if there's like, Udacity is the name of his platform.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And so I believe one of his is like how to write a search engine. And I don't know if it is applicable to this or not, but I would check it out because that might yeah. have a lot of really good information.
Okay, cool. So let's take one. Yeah, let's take one from the.
Here we go from our live viewers.
And I'll read it off and you answer. So.
Okay, all right.
So, this is a great question. So this is from Aaron Chapman, and let me see. I actually have this Chapman. He's from Eastern Alabama. So hey, Aaron from Eastern Alabama. cool. So. It says, I love everything Apple. I've written 5 iPhone apps on the App Store, study Objective-C and Cocoa Touch constantly, and I find it difficult to continue doing this because there's no one near me that's interested in programming. I'd be happy to learn other languages, but there isn't anyone near me. So the general gist of the question is sort of, how can you sort of get into a hobby like, you know, software engineering, programming, this kind of making apps, these kind of things, when sort of nobody like in your physical like vicinity is into it?
Yeah, so I mean, there's, you know, a couple of different ways. So one is, massively online learning platforms often have forums. And so you already know that people in some, if there's one that's in that domain, right, that they're like iPhone development, I'm sure there's probably some, you'll probably find that there are people there who are also posting in the forum and just kind of like start chatting with them. If you have ideas yeah. for things, try to say like, hey, you know, I have this, I'm sure there's an area devoted like, hey, like I have this idea, like anybody want to, you know, work on this with me or whatever. The other thing I would recommend is trying to find open source people doing something similar.
Totally.
So for mobile development, it's a little hard because the open source thing gets a little touchy depending on exactly what you're trying to do.
Yeah, like most open source people want to write tools and libraries and things like that, whereas like most apps are kind of end products.
But there you might be able to find something in that region, so that would be something else. And then another thing would be like, if depending on what you're interested in developing and then what you're trying to learn. So if you're trying to get connected with other people kind of to just work on something together, which is excellent, you know, resume builder for college, you know, admissions, for getting a job. You know, you might be able to go to something like, if you're interested in game programming, going to a game programming forum and finding people who are on a project and need help. Now, what you have to be careful is people there may not be as devoted as you are, or maybe more devoted than you're willing to be. Right. So you might have to do some kind of, you know, be upfront about like what your level of, you know, interest is and how much time you'd be willing to put into it. But you might be able to find like a match, right? So a lot of people are there looking, they have ideas and they're looking for developers. So that might be a good match.
Yeah,
or they're, you know, developers looking for other developers, right? So that's another thing to explore. And depending on what niche you're in, there could be a lot of people interested in that kind of.
Yeah, totally. I mean, so a little anecdote about this is when I did a lot of game programming, especially when I was younger, I just kind of went on my own. I didn't really like go to forums, didn't really pay much attention. So because of that, I wasted a lot of time. You know, like it wasn't wasted because it's kind of valuable, but personally, but as from a purpose of making something, it was kind of a waste. Like I spent all this time, you know, dealing with writing things to a file and reading them, whereas like I could have just used protocol buffers or Thrift, like we talked about in an earlier episode. And I just wasn't a very like efficient programmer. And on top of that, the even worse thing was that I made things that people didn't want to play. And it's like, and I had nobody but myself to really go off of, you know? And so, and I'm not Tarn Adams.
Even your mom wouldn't play them?
No, even my mom.
That's sad.
Yeah, she started and she was like, nope.
She's no.
Like, she's like, this isn't for hardcore players, so I'm out. But no, so it's like, I'm not Tarn Adams. I can't just like make genius like by myself. So it turns out that when I started getting into like 3D modeling and more artsy side projects, I got together with like Pixel Junk and some other forums, and I was kind of like sharing pictures, and they gave me a ton of feedback. I'm like, oh, you know, you're doing this totally wrong. Like, you're using this kind of, like, I was using an iconosphere instead of a UV sphere, and then it became really hard to texture. And they're just giving me tons of feedback, and that is incredibly useful. Like, now I feel like I can make 3D models like really well.
Interesting. Yeah, that's a good point. Put your work out there. So I was going to mention something similar as well, like start a blog, right? Like,
seems
kind of weird, but I mean, if you start and then just start posting like to various, you know, people that you admire, look up to, or other people who are doing something similar, say like, hey, you know, you should check out this. Like, what do you think? Do you have any comments? Could you like look at this and critique this for me or whatever, right? Like, I mean, it's hard to put yourself out there to, you know, be criticized, but, you know, just remember you're just like learning, right? Like, we're all learning. Like,
totally.
We have to remember that there are always somebody better than us.
Yeah, totally. And they are on that forum, no doubt.
I mean, just going to a popular forum is like, hey, I made this. Like, anybody have feedback? And you'll get some jerks on there, right? Like, people like, ah, this is terrible. Yeah.
I mean, you got to deal.
That's the internet, right? Like,
exactly.
That's what happens to me every time I try to play a game online.
Oh, that's the worst.
You're the worst!
I was playing Defense of the Ancients, which is known for having, like, big-time, like, trolls and trolls and things like that. And somebody told me the other day, they're like, I should kill myself because like I wasn't doing well in the game or whatever. And like, you know, of course it doesn't matter. But like, I just, for some reason, it like resonated. And I thought about it and I was like, you know, like this person, like they'll just say absolutely anything. Like they don't really like, it's not even like, I don't think the person, like what he's saying is even going through his head. You know what I mean? Like it's going through a part of the brain that just like blurts out. You know what I mean? Like doesn't actually think about it.
That's a shame. Yeah.
So you'll get all kinds if you go to forums. But, you know, a couple of forums I've been to, TIGSource, T-I-G-Source, which is game developer.
Yeah,
and they also have artist forums there,
if you're into games, that would be also really, like, the independent, but also the ones where they do, like, 72-hour thing, right? Like, develop a game in 72 hours, right?
Yeah, totally.
And then you submit it, and people review it. Like, they have a judge panel or popular vote or whatever, and people will give you feedback, right? Like,
yeah, and that's the other thing, too, is you realize, wow, this guy made an entire game in a day. And I like got my code to compile.
Ludum Dare. Is that what it's called?
That's
Ludum
right.
Dare? Yeah, check that out.
So yeah, you learn a lot of really interesting things from that. So yeah, hopefully that gives you some advice, Aaron.
All right, so I got another question here. So we'll try to respect the names that are in here, but hi, my name is Brian from the Detroit area.
Nice.
I love the podcast. Okay, maybe we won't read like, it sounds like really like self-patting on the back when we read the
quote unquote, air quotes, Brian, a.k.a. Jason. No, we're just kidding.
Okay, so his question isn't really about technology, but he's asking for our opinion. So so he's in high school, he's got a good GPA, and he's got you know, several friends who aren't really doing well with all the pressures of doing school. And he's doing research, and he discovered that the current school system is meant to prepare the students for, you know, basically a factory job. So this is like a, I've seen videos about this on the internet. Like we're, you know, this was meant to be a trade. We would go to work in a factory, get a pension, retire, right? Like this whole thing. And then that paradigm is changing.
The 9 to 5.
Yeah. And like, the, you know, they were meant to learn this way because this is the way the factory was. And now we're knowledge workers. Yep. You know, this is different. You'll hear that term. So it says, this worked perfectly for my grandfather who worked in a factory. But seeing as there are no more factory jobs, you know, at least in the United States, should it still really be set up that way? And should schools change to follow what occupations people will actually follow? So this is something I'm actually like really interested in. So having a young daughter, I'm interested in what should I save for college? College is gonna be really expensive by the time. Is college gonna be different? Should I just not bother? What should I encourage her to do? How should I help her? And I think there's a couple of things you have to balance here. Well, I guess I should have given this to you to answer. Sorry.
First, no, no.
Because I read the question.
We'll trade
it's
off.
Okay. So I like
I'm
this.
I'm glad that you're passionate about this question.
So there's a couple of things you have to balance. So one is when you're young, you often don't know what you want to be when you grow up, right? So like, I still don't really know what I want to be when I grow up to some extent. But you know, when younger you are, if you start too early, you're siloing people, right?
Yeah.
And then people kind of get too far into something before they realize it's not what they want to do. And then it's hard to switch. Because if you switch, you're giving up years of you know, experience in that thing that other people have and you won't have.
And actually, so having a family from Europe, you know, most of my cousins, my parents are originally from Europe. I noticed that they do this much earlier in Europe. So very early on, even as early as in what would be middle school over here, you know, you pick a discipline. And I noticed as a result that a lot of my cousins from Europe who also study computer science, because we're kind of like a nerd family, I guess, in the genes, but they're extremely good at like math and theory and computer, you know, science, things like that, but they don't really have like that creative, like the very broad creative, like they don't know the things that we know about like psychology, sociology, all these like gen ed, I think there is what it was called when I was in college. They don't have the breadth that we do, you know? And so I think it's actually just a great thing that we don't specialize early.
So but there is still like another aspect of it, which is, so you have that, right? It's like specializing and it is an issue. You have another, which is the way, like different people learn different ways, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of this is hard because it's a chicken and egg problem, right? So companies are set up to hire college graduates or, you know, take like a, you know, a highly skilled knowledge-based job like going to work in Silicon Valley for a large, let's say Yahoo. You're going to go work for Yahoo. And since programming Throwdown, maybe we'll pick a programming company, software company. So you're going to work for Yahoo. Yahoo is set up to hire people out of college.
Right, right.
You know, even if they've been in the workforce a long time, like they'll still assume they went to college at some level or have a really good professional background to hire them.
Yep.
And then colleges expect people out of high schools. And they expect them with a certain amount of level. And high schools have to expect middle school and on down. But as you're growing up, if you're going to go to college and college is a certain way, the high school has some obligation to help you prepare for a college that's of that type. Yep. So, you know, things like, oh, people might learn better by, you know, different methods or going online or playing games or watching videos. But if that's not an option for you when you get to college, now it's becoming less and less of that's a problem. But if you can't learn that way and get what's accepted of society today, the high school has failed you in some way,
right?
Because you're not prepared to go into college and learn the way, like learning how to learn. That's what you hear it and it's cliche, but like, oh, you're being taught not the skills, but learning how to learn so that when you get wherever you're going, you'll know like how to figure out what to do.
Yeah.
And so you have to balance that other aspect of it. And, you know, some people may learn really good in the current system and some jobs are necessary to do that way. And it is also important that we educate a large population to a certain level, like, you know, to have a good learned citizenry. And so that's important as well. But I mean, going forward, I think we are gonna see changes. We're gonna see shifts in how education's done and what's going on. And until then, we kind of just have to sit tight because big changes, you know, are also dangerous because although you may really like the idea of, you know, just going out and doing your own thing instead of going to college, you know, at this point, like you could do well. Like I know people who have done well doing that, but you can't really recommend that because we don't have a lot of statistics on how well people who do that do.
That's the thing. And the thing is, you know, with the exception of people like Steve Jobs and things like that, but for the vast majority, you know, chances are when you finished with your schooling at whatever level it is, you're going to apply for jobs. Now, if you know, if you're this entrepreneur like Steve Jobs and you're willing to go broke to like try and start a business, things like that, then it's sort of a little different. But for most people out there, even Steve Jobs worked at Atari for a while before he started his own business, and he was in college, you know, in and out of college during that time. So a lot of businesses, they get thousands of, like Yahoo probably gets thousands of applicants every day, maybe millions, right? Who knows? And so it's just not worth it for them to take a chance with somebody who, like, let's say didn't graduate high school, right? So it's just not worth it, because they know that, like, they would have to think of all the extra HR people, right? Like, if they could throw out, let's say, 10% of the resumes, then that's probably going to save them, what, like $60,000,
yeah, maybe $100,000. So we had this conversation. So right? It's the problem is, and this is depending on the size of the company, but if you take a normal medium to large company, it is so hard to actually fire somebody.
Oh, there's
for
that
so
too.
Many reasons.
Yeah.
So it is really, really, really risky to hire the wrong person.
Right, right.
And so what companies do, and it's to a shame, they miss a lot of good. We were having this conversation the other day about test anxiety, right?
Yeah.
So like some people just have interview anxiety, and it's a shame, but that company just can't. There's another person where that one came from,
right?
Right. And right. Somebody may look down the line and say that person went on to become the next Steve Jobs. Like, you should have hired them, maybe. But at the time, they're probably making the right decision by not, because
totally.
You know, they got to go with. In some ways, they're missing out on the best worker because they have to take a worker that they know will fit.
Yeah.
And that's changing some with, you know, remote working and, you know, people able to do other stuff.
Yeah, you can set up a presence online, which you couldn't do before.
Yeah, you can prove, like, here I have a portfolio of stuff I'm demonstrating. Yep. But at the same time, if you have that much initiative to not go to college and to do really well, like, and still learn, you know, you probably don't want to go work for one of those big companies anyways.
Yeah.
So, but I'm a big proponent of apprenticeship. Like, I think that would be really awesome and a good thing, right? Which is basically, instead, you would go to college, but college would be much more limited, maybe online, general education type, a little bit of specific. But then instead of all that money being spent, you know, to be taught, you would go apprentice with somebody. So people would offer themselves up for apprenticeship, and they would be trained as mentors.
Apprentors?
I think mentor. I don't know what the... Okay,
I'm master. I think a master. Is
maybe master. Okay, anyways, yeah. Whatever, right? And so like you would be able to find one and like, oh, I want to be a software engineer. And you would pay him. Why? Because he's going to teach you some of his secrets.
Yeah.
He's going to be less efficient because he has to teach you. But you're going to work alongside him. And in some ways, I think that would be better. But in some ways, if you go back and look at what apprenticeship was like, maybe we ought to be exactly. careful. And like
indentured servants. And
well, basically, so I read a little bit about people becoming like chefs. And so like you start off and like you're doing like that, you're like scrubbing mushrooms all night long for like weeks. Then you're like, you upgrade to like peeling carrots, you know, for like months. And then like you get to like dice something, you know, and like you keep getting yelled at by the chef and working horrible hours. And you do this for like years in the hopes that you might get a chance to like demonstrate yourself.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's better.
Yeah. Like, that's pretty
okay.
Rough.
So yeah, there's a balance like everything. And we need to explore options. But I think for now, in the short term, I don't see any big, big changes in the way companies will do hiring and stuff.
And the other thing, so the email seemed to indicate specifically like schedule. Like I remember, you know, when I went to high school, it's like when I was in high school, walked uphill. This is no joke. I had to get up at 4:30 in the morning to catch, because so real quick anecdote, I went to this kind of special school. The way my area in Florida was set up was they had special schools for people who had special interests. So like my interest is engineering, so they had an engineering school, and anyone within like, I think it was like 50 miles or something, could go to this school for free. They would bus you and everything, like as long as you had like certain aptitudes. So I went to a school that was super far away. The bus only picked up like 6 people, and I had to get up at 4:30 in the morning to get there by 7, right? It was crazy. And you know, I don't think I've ever woken up at 4:30 since high school, like ever. So it's true that like the schedule, you know, starting at 7 is kind of, you know, as computer science, we're kind of used to just getting up whenever, starting whenever, and you know, it's like, and then going, you know, working our time.
It's hard, right? Maybe I'm getting older. It's self-control, right? Like it builds character.
But yeah, that's the big thing, is I think that it's a combination of two things. One is school is as much a social, like, like learning platform as it is a way to teach you algebra and geometry and these things. So, you know, the fact that you're all in it together really means something. And I got a lot out of just being in a room full of people who are all doing the same thing. So I feel like that was a, like one thing that I'm thinking of right now is I made a calculator program which could do like the quadratic equation and things like that.
I think you told us this story, but yeah, go ahead.
Oh yeah, briefly. Real brief. And then, you know, the teacher.
Maybe you just told me, I don't know.
Possibly. So the teacher, you know, she realized we were doing this. She realized I'd given the program to everybody, and she, you know, made us all wipe our calculators before every test. And then, of course, I wrote that program again, and then I wrote a program that looked like you were wiping the calculator, but you weren't. It was pretty awesome. A little arms race going on there. But, you know, it's cool to get everyone in on it and something fun about that. And so to do that, everyone has to be there at the same time. And, you know, as parents now, we can start to understand, or at least you as a parent, can start to understand how hard it is to, like, work around your kid's schedule and, like, take them to school and get yourself to work and things like that. So, high school schedule, the whole school schedule, as a receiver of that schedule, it sucked. I hated getting up early and things like that. But now I can sort of understand why it is that way. And, you know, it's, Brian, you know, it really sucks getting up early, but then you can go to college in, like, did he say what year he was?
No.
No, but in at most 3 years from now, you'll be in college and you can set your own schedule.
So. I feel it's like the angst, like when you know something better is coming, and like you can see, like we can see now, colleges will change, like they'll change, but you're not sure quite how they're going to change. There will be some people who will take bold steps, and down the road will be, you know, praises heaped upon them as pioneers. But there will be a lot of people who try crazy things and kind of fail, and you'll just kind of forget about them. But you know, their lives might be. What is that called? I don't know. There's like a name for it, but basically, like, the personal risk to you is like very high. So like, if a huge amount of people try crazy things, some people will succeed, and then you have, you know, survivorship bias. Like, those are the people you'll remember, but there'll be a whole bunch of people who fall by the wayside as kind of crazies.
Totally.
You know, so there's a risk. But yeah, we feel you. I remember that.
Yeah, it was rough.
It does get better. All right, so here we go. You want to read this one?
Sure. This is from Joshua Brown. And unfortunately, Josh had to go, so he's going to be watching this
later.
What's the word called? Post-hoc?
Later.
He's going to be watching this later. But his question is, I'm just learning programming using your recommended Learn Python the Hard Way. My goal is to integrate Circos into Solus OS as a file manager. What sort of language should I be learning after I master Python to accomplish this? So I actually looked this up.
Oh, okay, good. I was about to say.
No worries. So yeah, I found this question kind of interesting because I didn't know what either of those two things were. So Solus OS is a Linux distro forked from Debian.
Okay.
So effectively Debian. And Circos is a pretty cool visualization library written in Perl where... you give it some XML in a certain format.
Oh.
It digests the XML and produces some really beautiful pictures.
Yeah, on the page notes. This is cool.
Yeah, so so the short answer, and then we can always jump another, you know, more detailed, but basically the Circos accepts XML, and so you can use any programming language you want. So, you know, there's XML writers for just about any language. Don't try and like write your own XML, like write the open tag, you know, write the greater than sign. Don't do that. There's XML writers. If you're using Python, which you said that you're studying, you can totally use Python. There's an XML library you can import. And it's pretty awesome. It lets you write XML. I've used it before. It's great. You can write your XML, and then the Circos program can digest it and produce those awesome graphs. So,
yeah, I mean, I think part of like learning programming, and this is something I struggle with, but is like struggling to do things in the programming, like the thing you know. So everything's a nail when all you have is a hammer.
Yeah, right.
Right. And part of what we talk about programming right now is learning like other languages. But go for it. Like try to, when you're learning a language, part of it is going for. If you only know one language, like trying to solve something before you realize like, oh, this is bad at this, and then you know what to go look for the replacement, like what characteristics of the replacement should be. And if you know multiple languages, you can't learn what the pros and cons of that language are until you try to do something and kind of realize like, oh, it doesn't really work for this.
Yeah,
or, oh,
totally.
It's really good at this, but really bad at this, right? And so, you know, I think that's like part of like the learning is like you kind of just have to go for it and see how far, like see where you'll get stuck. Because until you, like, I haven't done this before. Like, I've never, you know, integrated these two things together. It sounds kind of cool. Like, when I looked at that website, awesome. It looks really nice.
Yeah, Josh, real quick, sorry to interject. If you do this, let us know. We want to see it. And if it works on Ubuntu, even better.
So, yeah, I mean, like, I think part of it is, like, you know, nobody's done it before, so you kind of got to try something and then ask for help, right? Like, and then be like, oh, like, how do I do this thing? Like, oh, Python's not good for that? Like, oh, okay. And as you grow as a programmer, part of that is like doing that sooner,
yep.
right? So like, you know, you've talked about this with some of the machine learning algorithms, right? Like especially like AI stuff, about kind of pruning that tree when you're playing chess, kind of like understanding this path of plays goes nowhere good. Like I don't need to go process the whole thing.
Yep.
And like part of it is learning as you program, like that's heuristics. Like, oh, this language looks like it supports regular expressions really well. I don't care. I'm not going to use regular expressions.
Yeah.
You know, or like, ooh, this thing isn't performant. It doesn't run really fast. But that's okay because I'm doing something only once. Like I only need to do this thing once. So
yep.
That's not a huge thing for me.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, but that's a good question though.
It's yeah, great question. And Joshua Brown was from Los Angeles, he said. So
okay, cool.
Pretty cool getting questions from around the world.
Cool, and that's good. They look like open source projects then, right? So
yeah, both of those
a great way to get involved. It's really intimidating source. At first, like to get involved open source. It's yep. always like overwhelming and you kind of want to quit, but you just kind of have to stick in there for yep. a while, try it, and you know, eventually you'll start to make at least a little progress, and then
yeah, the cool thing that Josh is doing is that he already has something in mind that he wants to use this library for. So you know, if it turns out that the library doesn't work when I give it, you know, file names because file names have colons in them and the library crashes on colons, well, he's going to be really compelled to like go into the open source library, you know, fix the colon problem, submit a patch to GitHub where this is located and get them to fix it. And then you have a great feeling afterwards, like, you know, I made like contribution that made this library even better. And so it's pretty awesome. It's a great way to sort of get started.
Yeah, so as a slight segue, this is actually really interesting. So going from one company I was working at in Florida, which didn't do that much with open source stuff really,
mm-hmm.
Didn't like encourage people to kind of modify the source and change something to back to a company where it's actually been slightly a struggle for me. I've been criticized a couple times and also find other people doing it just blowing my mind where it's like, oh, the library doesn't support this. This thing doesn't work. Recompile it, change it, submit it back, you know, like fix yeah. it. Like, why are you like just changing what you do or working around it? Just fix it. And it's like, what?
Yeah, exactly.
Fix it? Are you crazy? Like, oh, and if you don't fix it, at least let them know. Like, you should tell that open source project, hey, I would really love to use it this way, and like, you know, you guys should fix this.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's pretty wild.
That's pretty a good awesome. Thing about working, I guess, out here in Silicon Valley is like people are more open to those kinds of things.
Yeah, totally. I mean, Silicon Valley has this thing where, you know, there's many startups. Like all these companies, like Twitter was a startup with like, who knows, 3-4 people, and then it grew, right? All of these companies started off very small. And so they're sort of indebted to these open source projects. Otherwise, you know, a small team wouldn't have been able to start something that investors could appreciate. So because of this indebtedness, there's like this philosophy in Silicon Valley that you give back and that you keep a healthy ecosystem so that the next startup can get going, right? And so
And it's probably like that in other places besides Silicon Valley.
Oh yeah.
Totally. I can't speak to the other places because I don't know.
Yep. Yeah.
So
do you want to read this one?
Sure. All right. So, hey guys, love the show. Okay. Is this you again? No. You wrote all these questions. So this is Mike from Virginia. All right. So, hey guys, love the show. Your discussion about the automated paper scanning to detect cheaters reminded me of one of my friends that is a teacher for an online school. She told me that they were looking to expel some of the students for plagiarism. They suspect the students are submitting the bare minimum to remain enrolled so they can collect the student loan money. Unfortunately, the teachers have to waste time dealing with these creeps instead of the actual students get less attention. Grr.
Yep. Grr.
I've heard of this over and over again from teacher friends and stuff.
Really? I've never heard of this.
Yeah, basically, like, it's really hard to expel students, and you spend way more time than you can really merit. And
wow.
So like even people who are doing deliberately bad stuff or cheating or whatever, like it's almost not worth your hassle.
So
just let it go.
This is sort of a digression, so I'll keep it short, but the same is true with renters. So I
yes.
have a friend who's renting his house to someone else because he moved, and the person just stopped paying their bill, like stopped paying their rent. And it turns out that it takes like on average something like over a year to evict somebody who's not paying their rent. It's just absolutely insane. Now, if like if they're doing other things, like if they're drinking or something, then like that can expedite it. But if they, especially if they have a lawyer or if they know the system pretty well, it can take over 12 months to evict somebody who hasn't. It's just insane. So.
Yeah, it's crazy. All right, so this question. Do you know of any free open source methods to sync mobile data between mobile devices more than one and a remote server? He's using Air mobile app and Microsoft SQL on the server, but he's open to other options. Seems like everything requires big time customization to do conflict checking. So it sounds like what he's trying to do here, I would assume, is for an app he's developing.
Right.
So trying to like have a remote server and synchronize. So I've not really done this before.
So, let's talk about files first. If you want to do files, there's a number of options. There's like Dropbox, SugarSync, these kind of things. Mm-hmm. And those are pretty awesome. You can actually put a file in your Dropbox, and it doesn't exactly just show up magically in your phone, which I wish it did. It's actually a big complaint I have with Dropbox. You actually have to go in your phone and say, hey, sync these files. So if you add a new file, you have to, whoop, lights just went out. Okay, they're back. So you have to actually like sync those files. But once you've checked the box for a file, then any changes you make on your phone like immediately go to the computer. And so this works really well for a lot of, like if you want to like make notes to yourself, things like that. With respect to actual data, this is kind of tricky, right? So the way most apps work is the phone might keep some local cached copy, but then it frequently hits the server, right? And so you might have some server that has one database, and then as the phone needs different pieces of the database, it can grab those, and if the phone needs to make updates. That's how like, you know, most apps work. In your case, it sounds like you want to keep, you know, the entire database on your phone and on the server and sort of keep the transactions in sync between the two. That's going to be pretty tricky. Yeah, I also don't know of.
So Air. Oh, that's Adobe Air. That's right.
Adobe
mobile app. Okay.
So I can't really think of anything off the top of my head. One thing you could do is you could have like a handshaking, like a negotiation thing. So basically, let's say you make the assumption that if there's a conflict, the server wins. So if you can work under that assumption, then you can have the phone and the server send messages to each other using Thrift or whatever. Maybe even Air has an RPC, like a remote procedure call framework. And so the phone would send a message to the server saying, hey, change this record, update this, like a new student has a test. Here's the student and the test and an essay or something, right? And the server can also say, hey, here's a student and an essay. If you get a conflict, like the same student gets like created with two different essays at the same time, you just let the server win. So the phone would just take the server's answer. And if the server gets a conflict, it would just throw out the phone's answer. You could probably code something like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little hard. I guess the details are a little loose. But another thing which I've used before is cheesy, and people don't like it. But so if you have one account, one person should be editing the data at a time. And so if that's the case, you can just have a method for basically determining if somebody's currently accessing or modifying the data, and other people have to be read-only.
Right.
So then every other, so essentially the server is only a server. Everything else has to become a client of some sort, even if it's on that computer. And when one is connected, until it either logs out or has some sort of timeout, everybody else can only be in read mode.
Yeah, makes sense.
And that, you know, that also will prevent it. It's a little cheesier, and you know, people might not like it, but it is simple and straightforward. The other thing would be this is like general advice, I guess, when you come across problems like this, is, you know, really just working on the Google for a while and like trying to like search out like other people who have had similar problems, try ways of rephrasing it. I know, like I find, and maybe this is not true for our listeners, but I find like people I know like in day-to-day life, like just aren't good at, so I say Googling, but I just mean searching, like being whatever, Yahoo, it doesn't matter what you use, but like understanding like how to try permutations, state it different ways, because you don't know, like part of the hard part is finding out what the word is that most people are using, because it might not be the same word you're using to describe the problem. And so again, forums can be a help there, because other people can help you with that if they're in the domain, but also just trying a little longer at searching and trying to find somebody else who may have encountered that problem.
Yeah, and the other thing is keep it simple, right? So in this case, you know, maybe where he's going with this is he wants to have like all the students' tests on all the phones so that they can scan, so that they don't have to hit the server every time they want to check if someone's, you know, cheating. But that might be like a nice optimization, but that might not be necessary. Like maybe the server could check for cheating like from everyone, every phone, you know. If you have like 1,000 users, then the server can check like 1,000 times, and it could even have a delay. It could say, hey, I'm checking 10 other people right now, like yours is in the queue or something like that. And that might be way easier than making some kind of crazy synchronization, you know. So keep it simple, try and keep everything on the server if at all possible. And if you can't do that, yeah, then you could do some kind of handshaking.
Yep. Yeah. All right. I think so. We're running kind of long on time already. We're already at an hour and 10 minutes. So we'll do one or two more.
Yeah, let's see. So we can do two more.
All right.
So we have Corey Reese, Corey from Texas. And his question is, what programming language would you recommend for a beginner?
Yeah, so I mean, we've talked about this a little bit on past shows. It kind of depends on what you want to do, but I like Python for beginners.
Me too. I was going to say Python.
But also, I mean,
We didn't rehearse that.
No. Yeah. But I mean, actually, Erlang.
Yeah, Erlang's
Pascal.
Good. Yep.
No, I'm just kidding. No, okay. Not so much those. I mean, you can, I guess.
If you started with that, you'd be like
an
really,
Uber programmer.
Yeah, you'd be really good at stuff that most people aren't.
So, I mean, I really think like Python is a good blend between like, you know, easy to use, but also, and like the batteries included we've talked about before in that episode.
Yep.
And also like being useful for real world things. If you want to kind of jump straight in, like Java or C++, right? Like, I mean, that's what still like most of the world's, you know, software houses are using.
Yep.
And so learning those from early, it's never a bad thing.
Totally.
But yeah, it's not as much reward up front. You don't get that immediate satisfaction the same way.
Yeah.
But you know, I'm also inclined to say JavaScript.
Really? That's interesting. Why JavaScript?
So, I mean, think about like all the, if you're going for like, if you're the kind of person who needs victories, like what better way, right?
That's true. You know,
so
if
like even if
JavaScript,
you write client server now with like Node.js, right? This is actually on a task of mine, probably longer standing than it should have been. So I don't know JavaScript that well. I haven't really done more than just very simple stuff. But like all the stuff I have a task of mine to learn it and to actually implement client server stuff completely in JavaScript.
Yeah.
With like Node.js and a JavaScript front end and web page development. That is just so. Like you could make good, earn a living at just, you know, doing JavaScript programming.
Yeah, totally.
Right? And so like and then also there's a lot of good tutorials out there because a lot of people who aren't expert programmers that's the first thing they learn because that's what they need.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of good resources out there. And you can do more and more than you ever could before with it.
Yeah, it makes it. And plus, like, you don't have to deal with deploying. Like, if you make some Java app, you have to like have people download it, and then half the people, they don't have Java installed, you have to deal with that. If you're writing something in JavaScript, you just make a website and you're like, hey, everybody, check out my website, and it just works, you know? So as far as like going back to what we were saying earlier about getting feedback and being part of a community and things like that, it's way easier to say, go on some forum and say, everyone go to this website, than it is to
forget
say-
Forget that, to email your mom or dad or your brother or sister or your cousin or your aunt and like, hey, like, what do you think about this?
Yep, it's much harder to be like, hey,
download
mom,
this Java and
install
run
Java,
this.
Download this 100 meg jar file that I have and then double click on it. Yeah, yeah. So JavaScript's actually an amazing choice. I didn't even think about it.
Yeah. Okay, so that's a non-personal recommendation. But like as far as everything I read, I mean, I wouldn't feel too bad about somebody taking that advice.
Yeah, totally. So one last question. This is from Joey Andres. And I'm using his email address to infer his location. His email address says he's from Alberta, Canada.
All right.
So we'll assume that that's true. His question is, he's a first year undergrad majoring in computer science. He's starting to realize the importance of number theory and invariance. What path should he take to sort of to understand more about like the math behind computer science? So how can he get into sort of the theoretical parts of it?
I think this is like the bowling ball is going straight down your lane.
Yeah, this is a softball. Okay, so I'll totally take this. Great question, Joey. So the mathematics of computer science is super, super interesting. You know, number theory, of course, incredibly important. A lot of interesting things there. I would think like one of the best ways to get into this kind of thing is to get into complexity analysis, because that's something you're going to have to do a lot of anyways.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. And that is something that's, it's sort of, it's very intuitive. Like the way it starts is, imagine if you have like a list of, you know, the way they do it typically is with sorting, right? So you have a list of numbers, and then they show you this thing called bubble sort, where you have two for loops, and then inside the two for loops you do some swapping, right? Or is there some, there's some conditional swapping there. And when you're done, the list is sorted. And you can see this takes n squared time. And you can actually see it in the for loops. Like you have the n, and then inside the for loop you have another, you have another n, so n squared. Then they get into like n log n and things like that. And then they show how things like a heap are order one on amortized order one. Even though there are cases where, you know, heap insertion and deletion, actually heap retrieval is always order one. Anyways, there's some algorithms like heap insertion, say, which can be order log n, but if you do it in a certain way, amortized, which means kind of like on average, it's order one. So anyways, these complexity analysis is a good way to get started, and it's really useful as an engineer to, when you're designing new algorithms, to say, oh, you know, this, if I design it this way, it can be like way faster. Like we're talking, instead of taking years, it takes 3 minutes, right? You know, some of the even more like deeply theoretical things about like, you know, complexity, not complexity, but like information, like how much information is there, like Kolmogorov complexity of algorithms and data and things like that. That stuff is super interesting, but that could be like a higher barrier of entry, you know? So by starting with complexity analysis, it's something like sort of easy to grasp. Then it's you can sort of jump into some of the other things.
Yeah. So I mean, I guess there's kind of two ways to view that question. I think that's probably like the way you're viewing. But other thing that, I mean, it's, you run into a lot in computers, depending on what you do, is even stuff that's not directly computer science but's related. So talk about like discrete math or whatever, like how floating point numbers work. So that can get interesting. But even less obvious things like prime numbers. So like, right, like calculating prime numbers, or, you know, geometric algorithms, right? Like kind of doing stuff that's like a convex hull, right? Like these kind of things involve math. And if you don't know what they mean, you can look them up. And so, you know, those things you do encounter in programming fairly frequently, and you hear them discussed. So those are, I guess, kind of related to like number theory type stuff or whatever.
Yep.
And those are interesting to me. I never got very deep into them, but kind of understanding them, because a lot of stuff like cryptography you come across has a lot to do with prime numbers and that kind of stuff. And then just getting more of an understanding of that kind of level of math can be really useful. And I find for that, I would recommend like something like Project Euler, depending on how you say it. Right? This is, you can search it, Project Euler. And they have various programming challenges, problems. And a lot of those, if I recall correctly, will involve you needing to understand things like, you know, how to find a prime number, or they'll actually give you kind of like a little bit of like, here's the certain kinds of numbers we're looking for. You should calculate these, you know. And these are highly related to like ACM programming competitions, if you see those, or something called Top Coder. So you can go on there. And those very deeply, Top Coder, for instance, or even ACM, will combine what Jason's talking about with what I'm talking about. So you'll need to know, on the one hand, like how are prime numbers calculated? And on the other hand, the default algorithm for doing that, unless the problem gives you some cheat, like way to shortcut it, like what would that complexity be?
Yep.
And could I do it in enough time? Or do I need to look for that shortcut, you know, and find out what it is? Is that the trick to solving the problem? And those methods are often, they'll have solutions for you. So you can see what you should have done, and then you can learn from that.
Yeah, another, just to recommend some reading material on this is, Algorithms in C++ by Robert Sedgwick, and maybe we'll post a link on the blog or something like that. But yeah, Algorithms in C++, it's actually two books. There's a volume 1 through 4, which got assembled into one book, and a volume 5, which takes up an entire separate book because it's so epic. But yeah, Robert Sedgwick wrote this Algorithms in C++ series, and has amazing like theoretical and application based like framework in it. So he actually talks about like max flow. So in other words, given a graph, and assume the graph are like pipes, and so they show how much water can go through these pipes, like how much, what's the maximum flow between two nodes? Like assuming that you could use all the pipes, right? So he actually talks about the mathematical like complexity, and then mathematical intuition behind how the algorithm works, and then he shows the algorithm. So highly recommended reading.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, it all depends on what kind of programming you end up doing and how much of this you need to know or don't need to know. But yeah, I mean, math is, I mean, there are people who major in math, right? So
totally.
So yeah, and computer science is closely related to math in many, many ways. So yeah, it can't hurt to learn that stuff.
No,
at least at some level.
Yeah.
So all right, well, I think that's a wrap. Thank you, everybody who was on at one time or another or is still on the Hangout. Jason's giving you a wave hi. And we appreciate it. And we are going to be back to our regular episodes. We'll have a language for our next time.
Totally.
And maybe we'll do another one of these mailbags. We'll see. Give us some feedback. Let us know what you think. Did we ramble too long? Were we too off topic? We're always pretty rambly. So, so it feels good.
People should be used to that.
Thank you for all your feedback. Thank you for all the questions.
Yeah, definitely. It's been awesome doing the mailbag, answering people's questions. You know, it's great that we sort of like aggregated a lot of these questions, and then we can sort of dedicate a whole episode to it. I think that this worked really well. I appreciate everybody's contributions, and
And thank you all for subscribing. We noticed increased downloadership.
Yeah.
So a lot of you are either downloading it multiple times, or
with you guys.
Or, we're just becoming more popular. We're not sure what it is. So if you're a new listener, again, like Jason said, well, you're too late now. You've already listened to this episode. But check out another episode, too.
Yeah, so, we released episode 20, maybe 3 weeks ago or something. And hundreds and hundreds of people have downloaded the episode, which is totally awesome. And, we appreciate all of your feedback and, questions and comments. So we have a few new languages. Some people said, hey, I don't have a question, but I want you to cover this. And we'll definitely be covering that for the next year. So, keep your emails coming to programmingthrowdown@gmail.com. And keep posting on G+.
All right. Thank you, guys.
Cool. See you later.
The intro music is AXO by Binar Pilot. Programming Throwdown is distributed under a Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike 2.0 license. You're free to share, copy, distribute, transmit the work, to remix, adapt the work, but you must provide attribution to Patrick and I, and share alike in kind. Hosting provided by Host Tornado. They offer website hosting packages, dedicated servers, and VPS solutions. HostT.net.
Programming Throwdown, episode 21. Mailbag?
So, this is a pretty exciting episode, mailbag episode. One quick thing before we get started, if this is your first time, if this is your first episode that you've listen to a different episode. So basically, this is, we've accumulated a lot of questions throughout the other episodes, and so this is our chance to sort of answer a lot of those questions and sort of engage in a dialogue about that. But this is deviating highly from the original format of the show. And so if you kind of want to get an essence of, if you want to learn a programming language or get an essence of the show, watch the 1-4.
Okay.
So, with that said,
Maybe actually the guests will be funnier than us, so then it'll make this episode better than the other episodes.
Oh, that's true. If you didn't like the last episode, watch this one.
Okay. And if anybody who ends up on this episode is better than us, we're going to kick you off and make you start your own podcast.
Yeah, totally.
So, anyways.
So,
all right.
So basically...
Take it away with the news.
News.
Or a personal... We have to start with the personal story.
So, they're having the hurricane, Hurricane Sandy. Actually, they had the hurricane.
Mm-hmm.
And, as Floridians, we've been through plenty of hurricanes ourselves. And one thing that I always wondered was, why don't they set up, why don't they have a mode in your cell phone where you can do like some kind of ad hoc? So, for example, let's say the cell phone towers go down, right?
Cell phone mesh network?
Yeah, like a cell phone peer-to-peer network where you could call people, and as long as one person in the network had access to the tower, then they would, you'd be able to get your call through.
Mm-hmm.
And so it turns out they have something like this, but for like policy reasons, it's not completely implemented. So in some phones, like in some circumstances, you can actually call 911 and it will route you through other phones, which is pretty incredible. And it's something that's not on by default. But so just a heads up for people, the technology behind broadcasting, and correct me if I'm wrong, you probably know more about stuff, but so any cell phone can also broadcast. So if you can receive, you can also broadcast. Something to do with the physics behind it.
It's a two-way communication.
Yeah, but so, I mean, the tower can talk to you and you could talk to the tower, but you can also talk, broadcast outwards.
Well, I mean, if you're talking to the tower, you are broadcasting.
Oh, really?
You don't
not
know
like
where
a
the
cone or something?
I mean, I don't. So yeah. That technology exists, but I mean, I think in general you just have a sphere around you of, you know, gradient, just, you know, going down by the cubelar or whatever power farther away you get.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, so that makes sense then. So yeah, you can totally do it from like a physics, math.
But I think the reason it's not implemented like overall is a couple reasons. One, like if you ever study like sensor networks or whatever, you know, it's like certain nodes happen to become like gateway nodes or like key nodes that a lot of stuff flows through. And if you become that guy, your phone's going to drain. You're just going to like have your phone in your pocket not using it and go back to it and be like, why is it all gone?
Oh, that's
right?
So true.
So like that would be that. So you have to have all this extra stuff to make it not be that. And the second thing also is that when the cell tower is broadcasting to you, it's got, for all intents and purposes, infinite power, right? It just sits there and beams out really strong as whatever limits they have set. But your cell phone has very limited. So it hears quietly, but then it also talks quietly. But the cell tower has very expensive antennas and equipment to be able to, you know, receive that quiet message and pick it up from the noise.
Oh.
So I think that's the whole mechanism. Versus if you're talking to other phones, it's not going to have the same range as you to the tower.
Gotcha.
Because the receiving antenna on the other phone isn't as strong. So it would probably work, and in some instances probably would be better, especially in densely populated areas like maybe like New York City or something.
Mm-hmm.
But in most regions, like I don't think you're going to, I wouldn't know what the range is, but it's probably not that far.
Oh, that makes sense. That makes sense.
That's my top of the brain response. But it would be cool for emergencies, like have a special mode you put it in.
So I think the way it works is the carrier can put your phone into this mode. And so then you
only if they can talk to your phone.
So how does that work? Oh, so I guess you have to get put into this mode like before a disaster or something. I'm not really sure. It's interesting though. I guess it works for hurricanes.
They anticipate the disaster coming.
Yeah, for earthquakes it might not work.
One of our listeners was pointing out Batman. Yes, this did happen in Batman.
Did it really? It's totally awesome.
They subverted the phone network to detect where everybody was. Wasn't that one of the movies?
Did you see the...
we should say spoiler alert. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. Well,
that's a really old Batman. But
it's
okay.
Oh, it's the original? Oh, then it's totally cool. Everyone's
not the new
that.
One.
Yeah. Right. So the did you see the Die Hard? This is the last Die Hard. It's like the Die Hard and Never Stop Dying or whatever. I don't know. Some cheesy name. But in the last one, they were going around trying to catch this hacker, and the terminology was like, it was like palm forehead the whole movie. It's like they've gone into our interwebs and they're stealing all the webs. There won't be any webs left, and it's just like, oh, come on.
Okay, actually, we're getting a correction. I don't like this. People are correcting us while we're talking. Normally, I like to pretend that we're always right.
Yeah. Every other episode, we're always right.
But we're allowed to be wrong. It's actually a mesh protocol network.
Ah, okay.
So I listened to the Twit. You ever listen to Twit? This guy, Leo Laporte or whatever, he has like a pretty popular like general tech broadcast. And he always has people in his IRC chat room. And sometimes they have conversations back and forth with the chat room or whatever.
Yeah.
And then, I understand now why he sometimes gets distracted.
Yeah, totally.
But it's good. It's good. Live feedback.
Yeah, this is pretty awesome. So the other thing that we should talk about is the election. There's, in case people didn't know, there's actually an election going on in the U.S., which some of you, you know, might not know or might not care about. But join us.
I'm not saying that.
I'm totally kidding. But no, it's super interesting. And the thing that's interesting to me is how every election, the technology changes, you know, drastically because the entire 4 years has gone by. And I feel this also with the Olympics. So, you know, as we talked about on that show,